every morning on BBC CWR. The people who are coming together, the people in your communities, my communities, who are keeping us all glued together. The mortar between the bricks of Coventry and Warwickshire. And the people who have, you know, frankly, used their entrepreneurial skills to recognise this time as an opportunity. Remember Kira and Sienna? We know them collectively as Sanhans, schoolgirl sisters from Kenilworth, who decided right at the start of the pandemic, March of last year, to launch a hand sanitizer business. One half of the sister duo, Kira, explaining at the time to us on BBC CWR what they started and how that evolved over the following 12 months.
At the height of the pandemic, it was apparent that it was so difficult to get hold of PPE, which became an essential for, you know, everyday life. And we saw an opportunity through a connection my dad had in Northern Ireland to get hold of hand sanitizer. And it kind of grew from there. We saw that we had an opportunity to help our mum, our family, and we thought, why not extend that to our local community and to wider communities? The demand for the food banks increased at a massive rate, but the supply just wasn't meeting that. And that was something that myself and my sister really wanted to kind of tap into. So we worked alongside the food banks a lot, but we have also given out over 10,000 hand sanitizer bottles to frontline workers over the past year, because it was very important to us that these people who, you know, at the time were risking their lives essentially to do their jobs needed to be protected.
Incredible that they first recognised the opportunity and then B, were able to take it up, move it on and make a success out of it. They've now been attributed to a Rotary Young Citizens Award, so they're quite something. I bet their dad's quite proud of them. Camillus, morning.
Hi, Phil, morning. How are you?
All right, mate. You?
Well, do you know, I was singing along to Brian Adams there, just reminiscing. Right. Oh, I got lost, mate. In 1992, I think.
What a tune that was. What a tune. Yeah. So you've got to be an incredibly proud dad as the way your daughter sort of reacted to this and sort of, I don't know, sort of, what point did the penny drop? They worked out, you had a contact in Northern Ireland. I thought, hang on a minute, there's an opportunity here.
Yeah, I think, do you know what, Phil? It was really a selfish thing at the very beginning, and it was based around my son, Charlie, the little one, just got scared seeing mum going to work every day. You know, everybody else's mum and dad were at home locked up with him, and his mum sort of walked out into the fire every day.
Yeah.
And she's
a healthcare professional, isn't she? So we should point that out. Yeah.
Yeah, my wife's a healthcare professional. She's from a BAME background as well, which obviously had you know, a level of complexity that went above and beyond the average person in the street, because there was that propensity really for it to impact the BAME community much more than the standardised community, so to speak. So yeah, it was about fear, and I think the message we started off was, look, how do we give them a bit of hope? Well, let's make sure mum's got the PPE that she requires. And at the time, it wasn't political. We all knew what was going on. But they just wanted to focus on, look, we don't care what the politics of the situation is. How do we get this fixed? So a little bit of pressure. I found my contact. And yeah, they started off, Phil. They stood at rugby grounds and football grounds in the rain, little pop-up stalls selling £5 here, £10 there, and then started giving them all away after that. And they wanted to amplify that. And I said, well, if you do that, you must be able to make a little bit of a profit.
Mm.
And so that's when they started to move into wholesale. And I think just people, because of the reality of the story and the understanding of the situation and the gratefulness for frontline workers, it really took off. Our local rugby club in Kenilworth were brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
Wasps then at one point got involved and allowed us to go up to their ground. Solihull Moors were fantastic.
Really?
You know, yeah. So the girls went from, you know, two or three little bottles to decking out a stadium with every element of crowd safety measure you can imagine, you know.
Amazing.
It was great. And, you know, some of their orders went as far as Peru. New York City, Spain.
Okay.
So they went global. Mind-boggling.
Yeah.
It went global. Yeah. And recognition was never the reason for starting. It was a selfish reason. They wanted to protect the mum.
Yeah.
That's all it was.
And that, I mean, that in itself is a great, you know, we call that a story arc, you know, in the media, a kind of a beginning point and how that sort of grew. And, but interestingly for me, Camillus. They didn't kind of, you know, sort of get lost in showbiz with that, did they? Because, you know, they got a fair amount of coverage for that, not least on CWR, but elsewhere, you know, nationally on the BBC as well. They maintain that kind of local community ethic by giving back to the food bank.
Yeah, it's not just... I'll tell you what's really unique, Phil, and it was a business model that was developed over time, was something really unique in what the Gurd's done. If you bought our product, let's say Aberdeen Football Club bought product,
yeah.
they would then say, okay, so 20% of that, tell me a cause in your local area, not in Warwickshire, not in Coventry, even in Peru, for example.
So
an example of that is we had an order from Northern Ireland recently, and 20% of that, we've said, great, where would you like it to go to? The guy in Northern Ireland identified a local family who'd lost a child, sadly, to suicide in Northern Ireland. And so the girls dispatched products, made bespoke masks for them at absolutely zero cost, sent them to the local corner shop, and they're now up there in the local corner shop for a suggested donation to that charity.
Amazing.
So it works really well. And in fairness, you're quite right, Phil. Most of our customers around the West Midlands and Warwickshire and Coventry. But that expanded reach and the way they were able to go national and even international on a few orders was simply because of that. They said, look, wherever you buy this, that's where it's going to benefit. So if you're buying it in Coventry, it's not benefiting Kenilworth Food Bank, it's benefiting Coventry Food Bank, or it's benefiting a charity in Coventry or in London or wherever.
Okay. At the weekend, they did get this recognition there, a virtual Rotary Young Citizens Award. They were honoured with that. So they'll again. I mean, you know, it's just another marker on this incredible journey they've had.
It's fantastic, and you know, I just hope, and I know that in years to come, when they're sitting in a pub somewhere in Ireland, back at home, you know, they're chatting, "Oh, do you remember coronavirus? What did you do? You know, banana bread, Carl Baskin, and Tiger King." And they'll go, "No, what we actually thought it was a great idea to set up a business in the middle of one of the worst worldwide pandemics ever." And you know, but there isn't anything more Irish than that, to be fair.
Whereabouts in Northern Ireland, Camillus? Just out of interest.
The Glens of Andermay. I come from Cushendall, near Bush Mills,
that
kind of direction.
All right.
And my wife is Indian. She's from the Sikh community.
Wow.
So cowboys and Indians in our house.
Ah, love it. All right. My mum's from Omagh, Clannabogan, just outside of Omagh, Tyrone. Yeah, and my dad came over from India, Pakistan in the 1950s. So very, very similar, mix. So I know the girls are going to be on with Brody a bit later, talk a bit more about this. I mean, at what point, Camillus, do you go, actually, you know what, I can step back as dad, and you are clearly business women in your own right, not just girls who've, you know, done well with one particular product here. You could actually, you know, from what you've learned and gained in experience, you could end up running another business and mentoring other people in business and, you know, it all sort of flowing from that.
Yeah, you know, Phil, that's exactly it. And I'm one of those dads that would, you know, old school, throw you in the swimming pool and see if you'd swim. And I use the exact same approach for the girls. And one of the proudest moments I had, if I look at it from a business perspective, was walking into a boardroom with a chap who was a multimillionaire, and introducing the conversation, having briefed the girls a little bit at 17 and 19 years old. And I just sat back and I just kept my mouth closed until the very last moment they needed me to speak. And they closed it themselves. They closed the deal themselves. They explained their social mission. They showed the passion. They let people understand exactly what they were trying to do. So they actually stood alone.
Amazing.
Probably two months, you know, maybe in May last year, simply because I stepped away.
Well, I mean, we're going to hear from them a little bit later, and they'll get loads of props, obviously, as individuals having done well. But you know what, Dad? Good job, you and their mum, because obviously that a lot of that's going to stem from the parents as well. So a little bit of credit for you as well, Camillus, this morning. And thanks for sharing that updated story with us. Thanks so much.
Well, listen, Phil, just very quickly, thank you very much to you, all the listeners on BBC Coventry and Warwickshire, because we got massive support through this channel and through the exposure that you gave the girls. And, of course, thanks very much to the Rotary Club as well for that recognition. Much appreciated, Phil.
Camilla Samuel, his dad of Kira and Sienna. You can hear them after midday with Brodie Swain today, making a difference in Coventry and Warwickshire and still doing it over 12 months. Brodie.